After running for more than 4 to 5 miles, according to our calculations,
then the Buddha said, I have already stopped. You are the one who runs. So he could not understand this. Then he said, how can you say you have stopped? I saw you are walking. And then the Buddha said, yes, I know that you cannot understand. I have stopped means I have stopped all the bad, wicked, cruel, harmful things, such as killing, long ago. But you are committing it. That is why I told you, I have stopped and you are running. Then this intelligent young man at once realized. And he said, very interesting. So instead of challenging, he wanted to know more about this doctrine. So after listening to the Buddha, he asked, can I follow you? Yes. Can I become a monk? Yes. He was ordained, become a monk. There are many occurrences, this kind of miracles. So when he come to know, the man's mind is very stiff, very stubborn, very skeptical. By knowing the mentality, he perform this kind of miracle. But not to glorify, to show others that he can perform many kind of miracles. Alavaka, a cannibal who lived on human flesh, Buddha went to see him. When you study the Buddha's way of life, there is another important thing that you can understand. Many other religionists, when they write the historical background, most of them are mythologies, how their religious teacher or their god destroyed many of those wicked, dangerous cannibals, devils, ghosts, how they kill and how they destroy them. There are many stories. I can give one reference in Bhagavad Gita. That's a very good book, just like Dhammapada, written in Sanskrit language. God says, Hindu philosophy, paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya cha duskritam dharma sansthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. God says, paritranaya sadhunam, to protect all cultured and religious and noble people, vinasaya cha duskritam, to destroy all those wicked people, dharma sansthapanarthaya, for the establishment of kingdom of righteousness, sambhavami yuge yuge, I appear on this earth from time to time, because they have 10 incarnations to tell us how this God appeared from time to time by taking different forms. are here. This religion says their God appear on this earth to destroy wicked people. But you cannot find a single incident during the Buddha's time where the Buddha had uttered even one harsh word to disturb others' mind without harming, without destroying, without killing. He knew the technique to convince those wicked people, and later advise them to give up this dangerous way of life. There are hundreds of stories, and this is the difference. So when he went to see this Alvaka cannibal, he was very dangerous. Everybody was shivering when people heard his name. He went alone. Usually when he goes out, some of his disciples like Ananda also follow. But this day, the Buddha did not take any of his disciples. He went alone. This cannibal was living in the jungle in a cave. When he visited that place, Alvaka has gone out. But his attendant, he was a very nice boy, told him, "Please don't come to this place. Do you know, my master is a very dangerous man. He lives on human flesh. So why did you come here?" Then he said, the Buddha, "Don't worry about me." He went inside his cave and sat down. He was waiting for this cannibal. When he came, he saw somebody sitting inside his cave, very strange. He could not believe his eyes. He thought, it seems that this man tried to show that he is also a clever man. Otherwise, how can he go inside to my cave and sit down like this? So, before I kill him, I must torture him. Just like a cat, after catching a rat, you know, won't kill at once. Go on playing, torturing. You know how they, exactly like this. He wanted to do the same thing to the Buddha. Then he came and asked Buddha, he shouted, he said, "Get up." Now see, the Buddha, just like a small, obedient boy, he got up. And again he said, "Sit down." Again he sat down. So he said, "Get up." He got up. Asked him, "Sit down." "Sit down." "Get up." Again he got up. "Sit down." Again he sat down. Fourth time, when he said, "Get up." Here, the Buddha's technique. The Buddha said, "I am not going to obey you. I am not going to listen to you. I am not going to get up. You can do anything, whatever you like." Now, then the pride, egoism that he had in his mind had to withdraw after listening to the Buddha, because this is the only technique that he had to adapt to tame this wicked man. Then he said, "All right." He was defeated. He turned the other way around. He said, "All right, now I am going to ask you some questions. If you could not answer, He said, I take you by your leg and throw to the other bank of the river. There was a river nearby that area. If not, I split your heart. Then the Buddha said, these wordings you can see in Alavaka Sutra, the language spoken by the Buddha in the Pali language. He said, Nakvahantang avaso passami sadevake loke samarake sabrahmake sa samana brahmaniya pajaya sadeva manusaya. The Buddha says, you must understand. There is nobody in this whole universe, not only on this earth, even in heaven or hell or anywhere, in any part of the universe, who can do that kind of thing to me. You better try and see. Again he had to surrender. See the technique. And the Buddha says, don't talk too much. If you've got any questions, you can ask. Then he asked a series of questions. He started, there are so many. He asked, Kim sudhavittam purisasya settam Kim susuchinno sukhamavahati Kingsu ave sadhu tarang rasanam katang jivin jivitamahu sittang. This is the first one. Very meaningful questions. Kingsu dhavittang purisasa sittang. What is the highest wealth for man in this world? That is the first question. There are few more there. Then the Buddha started. Saddhida vittam purisasa settam dhammo suchinno sukhamavahati. So, answer to your first question is, Saddhida vittang purisasya sittang. The highest wealth for a man is confidence. Very meaningful answer. You are waiting to hear whether it is diamond or gold or something else. Highest wealth. And see the way how Buddha has given the answer. Highest wealth is the confidence. If there is no confidence in our life, we cannot do anything in this world. First, we must have self-confidence. Then we develop our willpower, determinations, and understanding. We never surrender for unnecessary things. We never succumb to all sort of superstitious belief if we have self-confidence. We never create undue worries and miseries and so many other problems. Due to lack of this self-confidence, we create all these things in our mind. Again, at home, you have confidence. Husband and wife, parents and children. Then you can extend this. And you can see the richness of this confidence. Now this is another technique, but many people regard this as a miracle, because another person cannot tame, because this cannibal was regarded as a devil, as a demon. Others are scared of him. The Buddha had the courage to face him, challenge him, enlighten him. Later, he became one of the best followers among the disciples of the Buddha. Then the Buddha has introduced this ආලවක හත්ාලවක is number 1 disciples among the lay people who developed more saddha, more confidence. Among millions of other devotees, lay people, Buddha says, my disciple Alavaka is number 1. His devotion, his confidence is unshakable. Under any circumstances, no one can shake his confidence. How he developed that cannibal to lead a noble life. Then there are some occasions where the Buddha has condemned certain disciples, the monks, who have performed the supernatural power to show others how clever they are. Buddha never agreed with this. One incident, a man who wanted to challenge with all those religious teachers, because there were many religions in India at that time. What he did, valuable vessels, he fixed on the top of a huge bamboo stick, very high. Then he announced, if there's any religious man who can perform miracles without climbing this bamboo tree, must go and bring down this vessel. And so many religious teachers, leaders came. Some of them just tried but no wings. Could not climb. Because they thought they had that power, but they could not climb. So one of the disciples, his name is called Pindola Bharadwaja, the monk. He has developed this power. It is not an extraordinary power. And that is why we take these things as miracles. Because we cannot understand how they perform this. So one day, when we come to know actually how to do that, and no more miracles. And this is the nature of all these miracles that which exist. It is due to our ignorance we take them as miracles. One who developed meditation through jhana, samatha. Samatha is one method for meditation. Only through this method, the meditators can gain jhanic power. It's called absorption. I don't think that word gives the real meaning for you to understand what it is. To perform certain thing, just like flying in the sky like birds, and walk on the water, and appear and disappear, are these kind of things. Many disciples have developed this power. Some of them have abused, misused, because they gained this power without proper mental purity. If the mind is not pure, if craving or jealousy or anger remains in that mind, people can misuse this miraculous power to harm others, to disturb others, to frighten others. So Devadatta, another disciple of the Buddha who gained this power, abused, he misused. So this is not a new method. This method was very common in India even before the Buddha's come into existence. Anyone without even any religious label who practiced this meditation gained some sort of jhanic power. But after gaining this jhanic power, they thought, this is the ultimate aim, final goal, highest achievement. Later, they have lost everything because they never knew that they have not eradicated all their mental defilements. Still they have craving, still they have ignorance. So by keeping many of these mental defilements, people can develop this meditation method and gain some sort of power. So they perform this thing just to show others. Those who are greedy misuse for their personal gain. Now if you learn this technique through this meditation, say to appear and disappear, I think there will be a lot of bank robbery in the town. You suddenly appear there and disappear with the money. This is the way how you can misuse. Now you can understand why the Buddha did not encourage. So this particular monk, he wanted to show, he climbed like a bird and down the vessel. When this news was spread, people started to appreciate and follow him. Oh, he's a very clever, he can perform miracles, thousands of followers. Then the Buddha seemed to come. Yeah, is it true that you perform this kind of miracle? Yes. Now you have many followers, isn't it? Yes. Do you think all those followers have realized the Dhamma? Did they learn anything? Nothing. Just for curiosity's sake, they followed you, thinking you are a powerful man. They have no wisdom, no understanding, no knowledge, no purity, no enlightenment. That is not the way to introduce a religion. Buddha has given a warning. You must never perform this kind of miracle to influence people, to drag them into your religion. Today you can see all over the world, so-called religionists and missionaries perform many kind of monkey tricks. They are real monkey tricks, you cannot understand, to introduce religion. And people follow them not knowing the nature of their tricks. Here the Buddha's attitude. Then he said, if you try to influence people by performing this kind of miracles to introduce Buddhism, he has given a parable. Whenever there is a performance or dance, people can invite a very young girl, a naked girl, to come and dance. And people pay more attention to see this dance. It is exactly like this. If you try to introduce Buddhism by performing this kind of miracle. And today, how shallow, how narrow your understanding about the Dhamma or the Buddha or Buddhism. Whenever a monk or somebody come to this country, and another person say, you know, he's a very powerful monk, he can perform miracle, he can do this, he can give a very powerful mantra, you never die, you know, if you recite this mantra, never fall sick. Thousands and thousands of them follow. That means your knowledge, your understanding is very, very shallow. But after learning the Dhamma, you can understand. So, supernatural power, just now I told you, certain phenomena happening, we can see We cannot deny. Few examples. After attending to a religious service or prayer or chanting, many people come and report the sicknesses they had earlier completely disappear, no more. It is a miracle, real miracle. I went to that God, this God, I pray, now I feel much better. Miracles. I recited that sutra, I listened to the chanting. I have been suffering from this and that, after this, listening to this chanting, that sickness also disappeared. So we take this as a miracle. Because we do not know how this chanting or prayer or mantra work. There are many reasons. First thing, our belief, faith, devotion. Without these things, for curiosity's sake, simply by attending any kind of prayers or chanting, you won't gain anything. First, you have to develop faith, devotion, confidence. When you develop this mental attitude, do you know how many changes take place in your mind? You cannot understand that. Then, the environment, sound vibration, and the power of certain wording, certain words have power. The rhythm, there are so many factors which contribute to change man's mind, not only human mind, animals. Today, people have done lot of experiments. How far they can influence other living beings, animals, birds, fish, through music. Some people, when they want to catch fish, they use some sort of musical instrument inside the vessels and inside the water and going on playing this instrument. That sound vibration attracts the fish and goes inside and catch them. Birds, a snake charmers. When they use that, what do you call it? I don't know all those names. You can see how that cobra dance according to the tune, like this. They follow the tune. Certain birds, when you do some chanting and some music, you can see how they listen, like this, turning this way, turning this way. They enjoy the music. Not only animals and birds and snake, plant life. It is a fact how rhythm, music, tune can influence the plant life to produce more flowers and more fruits. A scientist has done an experiment. He planted two trees, very young ones, and provided same fertilizers, soil and water to both. Every morning he goes there and use music and love and trust. I love you. I like you. I want you to grow. Every day go and sayang this tree. Then he goes to the other tree. He says, I hate you, you dirty fellow. I don't like to see you growing. He went on doing this for some time. But he provided the same food, fertilizer, soil, water, both. After some time he has seen the result. How this one grows rapidly, produces flowers and fruits, and that one is already very, very, very slowly growing, 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 but no fruits, no flowers. Human mind, mental vibration, and radiations of kindness, music, and the rhythm, influence, everything, even the plant life. So when we listen to certain chantings or prayers, many of our sicknesses created by the mind, we have not learned how mind creates sicknesses. We have noticed within few minutes we can see the result, how the mind creates sicknesses. A lady who went to Cameron Highland for a holiday, very rich lady. There was nobody at home, only servant. The same night, thieves entered into the house and taken away some valuable things. Jewelries. And somebody telephoned to that lady, thieves have entered into your house last night and we do not know what they have taken. Within few minutes, that lady had rashes all over the body. The shock and the mental disturbances immediately affected the glands. Various glands. Then these glands, all of you know, decrease various kind of hormones and juice and this and that, and completely pollute the blood. Then rashes. See how mind creates sicknesses. I have seen another incident here. We had tuition at night time. One young girl, I think time was about 9 o'clock. She was waiting alone there in our veranda. Nobody around this area. And she was belonged to another religion. Not used to Buddhist temples and this, but just come here to take tuition. So when he was sitting there, I went to talk to her. I asked, why are you waiting? When she saw me, actually she got a shock. Because our figure is not very appealing to their mind. You know, some people get shocked, you know, when they see us. Then I talked to her. She said, shivering, told me, I am waiting for my father. What happened? Don't know. Have you got telephone number? Yeah. Then she was shivering and gave me the telephone number. Telephone. They say, he left already. He says, still didn't come back. Then I told her, you should not worry. Your father is on the way. He is coming. If he could not come, what we do? We can inform the Brickfield police station and send you home. You are saved. Still, she had that fear. Then she had the difficulty of breathing. Then I asked, what is wrong with you? She told me, she used to get this asthma occasionally, whenever there is any disturbances, how the mind aggravated asthma, now had difficulty. Then I prepare some coffee, gave her. She refused to drink because they don't like to eat or drink anything from us. How the mind aggravated asthma, now had difficulty. Then I prepare some coffee, gave her. She refused to drink because they don't like to eat or drink anything from us. This is the problem with this religious, very unfortunate, you know, religious discrimination, hostility, and our stupidity also there. So, we can give thousands of examples to tell you how mind creates sicknesses. If not, we get a sudden shock. Then many people, how many times they go to toilet? Because that affects the gland and secretes so many juice into our stomach and upset the whole thing, and the stomach cannot tolerate. And those who are suffering from gastric ulcer, then sometimes hemorrhage can take place in the stomach. Those who suffer from blood pressure, brain damage, hemorrhage, blood clot take place because of that shock or the fear, tension. Thousands of sicknesses we create because of our mental attitude. And today, in the West, many of those who are not Buddhist, they practice this meditation to calm the mind, to avoid these things, at least for a short period. Then they say, how nice, very soothing. Recently, they have done another experiment in America. I don't know whether our good friend knows that. They wanted to test the human mind, how mental vibration can create poison. Because every time, through our inhaling, exhaling, breathe in, breathe out, and we never concentrate, and we do not know actually what we are doing. So when we breathe in, we take the cosmic energy into our body. When we breathe out, then we transmit our vibration through our nostril, and this mix up with the environment. So when we develop anger, hatred, jealousy, ill will, grudge and evil forces in our mind, all these are evil, poisonous, dangerous mental thoughts. So when we breathe out, all these evil forces mix up and pollute the purity of the atmosphere. Again, when we breathe in, if you do that while maintaining all the evil forces, thoughts in our mind, the cosmic energy that we take in to our body, also again we poison. So what they have done, allow one man to concentrate, meditate, one-pointedness, without thinking, taking many objects into the mind, and they fix some sort of tube here and the other end into a bottle. And another man, without telling him, They told him that they want to do some experiment. For what purpose? They did not tell him. He irritated, make him angry. And again fixed this one into his nose and put the other end into a bottle. And collected this, you know, when you eat out into a glass, you can see, for about half an hour. After that, they have collected certain substance and mix up some chemical and boil. And the person who developed his anger, hatred, ill will, created lot of poisonous gas into that bottle. When they boiled this one, they found a little bit of yellowish substance, about a pinpoint. Then given this to an animal, like guinea pig, and that animal died. See how poisonous. When we develop these hatred, anger, jealousy, ill will in our mind, how we pollute the purity of the atmosphere. And the other person who concentrated without provoking, irritating his mind, also collected something, boiled, and collected nothing. They are doing a lot of experiments. So 2500 years ago, the Buddha has advised us to develop, but we have not taken seriously because we could not understand. Now you can understand how mind creates it. So the sicknesses created by the mind can be cured by using the same mind. So what we do, through these prayers, under any religion, it makes no difference, whether Islam, Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, or any kind of ism, no difference. We have to develop our faith, devotion, confidence, that's all. Many people come and tell us, even pray and pray, now they feel much better, no problem. But they don't know who answered. They say God answered their prayer. But they don't know who really answered. Their own mind answered this prayer. Chanting also exactly like this. When you do some chanting with devotions and confidence, and the sound vibration, rhythm, so many things, you really can get rid of many problems and very bad atmosphere at home and sicknesses. We regard all these things as miracles. But when you study, there is no miracle. All are natural, but to us they are supernatural. Because we cannot understand. Then the Buddhist attitude towards this kind of miracles, I told you, very unfortunately, many religionists have learned various kind of technique to influence others by showing certain tricks as miracles. I think you can remember a few incidents I have mentioned. A lady in Indonesia, few years ago, a pregnant lady, about to give birth, Then she announced the baby inside in her tummy is praying, can hear the sound. So people come and listen. Yes, it is true. Then announced, a new prophet is coming. He is so impatient, he cannot wait until he come out to pray. Started praying inside the mother. Thousands of people assembled, then started praying, worshipping, offerings, and this news spread everywhere. And there was a cunning man. Cunning man is a wise man, you must understand that. You know, cunning man is not a bad man. Cunning man is a wise man. He knew that there must be some sort of tricks. He came and asked her to remove these so many layers and found out a small tape recorder. If that man has not discovered this, they introduced thousands of people, announced this as a miracle. Another incident in clan. They have seen suddenly the water started to, what you call, sing up. But no pipeline there. They went on digging here and there, no pipeline. Then announced, this is a miracle, the holy water sent by the God. People started coming with bottles and buckets and collecting so many water. After drinking, they say, yes, I have been suffering from this trouble, my headache, now no more. I had backache, I think only 2 or 3 days, now no more. Because they take this with so much devotion, faith and confidence. Then another man really wanted to find out the secret of this. He went on digging and digging and digging, and later he found out a rotten pipeline was burst from there and water started coming, spring. Miracles. A group of people were having a meeting, a mixed crowd, followers of various religions, in a big building. Then suddenly the electricity was gone out. Oh, no light. And they say, nothing wrong, only in this building. Then they went on searching, they cannot find out any mistake. Then they say, all right, now let us pray to our respective gods, because this is a mixed crowd. So some people started to pray God, Jesus Christ, but no light. Some others pray to Goddess of Mercy, no light. Some others pray to Buddha, no light. Some others pray to Krishna and Rama, no light. But this particular group belonged to another. When they started to mention that particular teacher's name, suddenly light appeared. One man who was behind there, seen, at that time, slowly another man goes and switch on the light, you know that. At that time, miracle. If that man has not seen this, see the way, when we recite name of our teacher, suddenly light appears. Miracle. Few years ago, everywhere people started to take a miraculous chapati. You know chapati, what Indian people take, roti. They make one chapati and pour tea water must pour tea water into this in the evening. Next day morning you can see so many layers. They say at night the God come and multiply. That you take this, then your cancer, your gastric ulcer and everything disappear. It was spreading very rapidly everywhere. One doctor at the university hospital wanted to see actually what it is. So he also made so many chapatis, not only one. He poured water, cold water into one, hot water into another one, coffee into another one, tea into another one, because he wanted to see what it is. Next day morning, he found out only that particular one where he poured tea, water, multiplied, but not others. Then he done some experiment, found out the tea, that is, create this, what you call this, the thing that you use to multiply your, what do you call it? Yeast, that's right, yeast. Because this news item appeared in the newspaper, then that miracle also disappeared. All those miracles that we accept for a certain period remain as miracles until we realize what it is. So many religionists use these monkey tricks to introduce their religion. So far I have never heard that Buddhists are using this kind of technique. I do not know whether there are. There may be some to introduce Buddhism, this kind of tricks. So, this is the way how they take the advantage of our ignorance. Because we believe at once. The first advice given by the Buddha is this: not to develop your faith at once, to accept anything. If you accept anything at once through your faith, later, when you come to know the truth or facts or reality, you never give up this faith. This is the danger, because this belief is already crystallized and you try to justify. I can give another example. I think nearly 1,000 years ago, very devout Chinese lady in China, when she heard some pilgrims are going to visit holy places in India, she told these people, I heard that you can find the two relics of the Buddha in India. Can you please find out one for me? She thought that two relics is very common. Anyone can find out two relics. So they accepted. They have visited India, completely forgot about it. On the way, when they were returning to China, they suddenly remember that poor lady, and we also promised. So what to do now? When they were thinking, and they saw a dead dog on the roadside. So they have taken one tooth and washed and cleaned and wrapped it nicely and went to China, hand over, like this, this is the tooth relics of the Buddha. This lady was so happy, with so much devotion. She has put up a pagoda and spent so much of money, very rich lady, and and more people started coming. This place has become very popular. Truth relics of the Buddha, only truth relics. Then, those people who brought this one thought, I think this is a very bad mistake we have done. We have misled thousands of people, so we must go and reveal the truth. So one day, one of them came and told this lady, actually this is not the truth relics of the Buddha, and this is this, and you talk rubbish. How can you say like this? Every time when I come and worship, I can see the brightness, light, the different colors, rays come out from this place. This is a real Buddha relic. Mad fellow, go away. That is the trouble. Now you can understand why the Buddha did not encourage us to apply faith at the beginning. Because later you will come to know that it is not true. But it is too late for you to change your mind. You justify. Then you become very the fanatical religious man. Because you cannot use your sense of reasoning after that. The Buddhist attitude is, first, you must try to learn. Now you are here every Friday to learn something. Otherwise, without coming here, you can develop your faith and belief. Not necessary to learn anything. First, you try to learn something. After learning, you think. You have human mind to think. When you think, still you have some difficulties. Why? The former concept reject these new ideas. Now when we talk, always we give some new idea. But your former faith, belief, reject this thing. And this is the biggest problem. We have so much of superstitious belief in our mind. Traditional belief. Our own imagination. So those things cannot agree with this new idea. Same thing has happened to the Buddha. So after gaining his enlightenment, when he wanted to preach and tell others, many people completely rejected, objected. And one man, when the Buddha explained few words of his Dhamma, very fanatical believer of one religion in India at that time, after his preaching, so do you know how this man acknowledged? That's all. Because his mind cannot accept it, rejected everything. So it is very dangerous for us to accept anything at once through faith, whether religion or anything, any news. We learn and we think, and after that we also investigate. Reason out. Try to understand whether it is true. And then there will be many evidences to prove, yes, it is true. This is the advice. Pachyattam veditabbo vinyohi. The Buddha's advice. So each and every person individually can understand to their own experience without depending on another person. Now if you say, we must accept this because the Buddha has said, that's all. but you never learn anything. Again, in Kalama Sutra, the Buddha said, don't accept anything thinking that the Buddha is a great man. You depend on person. You develop personality cult. Never realize the truth. Always people come and tell, well, people say, do you know, majority here in this world are fools. Very few are intelligent. You can say, more people follow this, then you also must follow. That is not the way to understand the truth. Think, then you can understand. Not at once, take time. So when I was studying this teaching, started more than 50 years ago, I started to learn. Still learning. Every day I learn something, some new idea. Therefore, I never think I am learned. Still I am learning. And many things that I have learned earlier, when I was young, the idea or my own imagination that I have created, later I came to know it's wrong. So I had to withdraw that former concept or belief and replace with this new idea. And this is called learning. You cannot learn anything if you keep your old rubbish dung in your mind. You had to empty so many rubbish from your mind. So many superstitious ideas you maintain, developed by people of thousands of years due to lack of understanding.